With a $4 billion budget deficit, the state faces a risky balance, encouraging development in oil and gas while Alaska's budget continues to shrink. Tonight, a special presentation by Channel 2 News and 360 North, The State of the Budget, Rethinking Oil and Gas.
Good evening and welcome to our program. I'm Steve McDonald of Channel 2 News.
And I'm Andrew Kitchenman of Alaska Public Media and KTOO in Juneau. Tonight we're in the capital city to talk about an issue that's created gridlock in the legislature and brought the session to a standstill.
It's the debate over the subsidies and tax incentives for the oil industry. The oil incentives total hundreds of millions of dollars, growing to the point where they've become the third most expensive item in the state's budget.
With the state facing a $4 billion budget deficit, the incentives have become a prime target for cuts. During our program, we'll discuss the proposed cuts and their impacts with our panelists.
On our panel is State Revenue Commissioner Randy Hoffbeck. Mr. Hoffbeck, thanks very much for joining us tonight. And next to Mr. Hoffbeck, Garen Tarr, representative from the Anchorage area and a Democrat in the state legislature.
Republican Representative Paul Seaton is from Homer, and next to him is Representative Dave Tallarico, who is also a Republican from the Healy area.
Folks, thanks for joining us here tonight. Mr. Hoffbeck, we'll start with you. Since it was basically your boss who got this all started, Governor Walker, he is proposing cuts to oil and gas incentives. And why does the government feel there's a need to make these reductions?
As you said in the introduction, it is our third largest expenditure right now. And we're in a situation now because of extended low oil prices and actually reduced production that's been occurring for years, that we just simply can't afford to pay $700 million in credits on an annual basis when we balance it against other programs.
Representative Tarr, many Democrats have called the tax incentives giveaways for big oil. The House of Representatives is split over this issue, which is one of the reasons why we're in day 106 of a 90-day session. Where do you come down on this issue, and is there any reason to hope that an agreement is near?
I'd like to think an agreement can be near. Reform of our overly generous oil and gas tax credit system has become a number one priority for the Independent Democratic Coalition and the Senate Democrats. And not only is it part of the overall sustainable budget plan that's been put forward by Governor Walker, it's the biggest piece actually at $500 million.
We asked for your comments and questions. Tim Fitzpatrick asked via Twitter, what effect on jobs, investment, and production will a tax increase have?
Well, I think that's where, when we talk about the fair take for Alaska, but the ability for our industry to continue to invest, that's the whole idea of the job impacts there. And my concern is, we talk about all the other things that we need to fund and how much money we'll need to do that. What type of revenue do we need to generate? At the same time, what type of revenue will we pull out of the private economy? How are we carefully going to navigate this to make sure that we don't have this major elimination of jobs, that we don't spin ourselves into a giant recession, in particularly in the private sector? And there's already been job loss that's happened. And I just had a story from somebody that said, hey, three new for sale signs went up on my street in Anchorage. And I, of course, don't know too much about Anchorage. But those impacts can be felt all over the state. So we have, I think everyone's very concerned about that, and I think we need to navigate this very carefully. We obviously have the revenues for the state and the services that we provide, which are vitally important. But our private sector economy is vitally important to everyone in Alaska, too. I put a lot of value in a job, for sure, so that someone can go to work and come home and support their family and do all those things that they do in their community. That's really important. So I think we're still moving very carefully and very strategically to try and find what I guess I'll call that sweet spot. And we need to find that sweet spot where we can settle on that.
Mr. Seaton.
And I'd just add that, I agree that those are important, but industry, private industry, is making determinations based on if they're making money or if they're losing money. I mean, that's their job. And so they're making lots of cuts because the price of oil is at a point where they're losing money on every barrel they produce. So they have to look down the road and see what those costs will be. And our question has to be also, how much state subsidy can we give a company and change their behavior? I mean, if it costs $10 a barrel of oil of subsidy to have them continue drilling a certain operation, but if you're giving the money to the company and there's no security that's what they're going to use the money for, is maintaining that rig working, then that becomes a very difficult situation as well. And the way our tax system works, it's company-wide. So whether it's they use that money for Alaskan operations and maintaining Alaska operations, or maintaining operations in the lower 48. We don't have any control of that under our current system.
So building in flexibility is key to this next plan that's approved?
I think we have to reach that basis where we are able to change behavior in the appropriate.
Heard in my ears, and what is the holdup? what is the main disagreement in this bill, so people can understand at home why are we at that? Well, like we said before, it was gridlock. Where is there any one particular area that needs to be addressed here?
Well, I would say one of the. We're talking about the Rules CS, the Rules Committee substitute that has been proposed, hasn't been heard yet. The problem is that it gets rid of credits, but it allows all the lease expenditures to be carried forward and then credited against tax at the same 35% rate. So you got rid of 35% tax credits and you rolled forward the lease expenditures and let them be taken at 35%. There's really no difference in the money. There's a little difference in timing because credits can take the minimum floor down to zero tax, whereas lease expenditures rolled forward can only go to the minimum tax, and so those extra lease expenditures continue to roll forward, but it still offsets state revenue at exactly the same rate as we currently under. Mm-hmm. So it creates huge ongoing liabilities. So there are other proposals out there looking at having those lease expenditures be used in the year they occur, but not go forward. And that is a different way of looking at things, and we don't allow revenue from one bill or from one year to be shifted to another year to change your tax rate, and we shouldn't allow, in some of our views, lease expenditures to be rolled forward and offset future revenue. So that's a debate that's coming forward, and that kind of proposal gets us out of the digging the hole in the treasury at the same rate we currently are. Credits or lease expenditures rolling forward at the same rate is problematic.
Mr. Tallarico?
And I think we still have to, we'll still be looking at that as the incentive to produce, and looking just a few years down the road. We've got that fine line where we want to make sure that we have oil in the line. That's going to be our major revenue source for quite a few years to come. And we have to be very careful that we maintain that incentive to produce and keep oil in the line. This was the only year in probably the last 15 or maybe longer than that where we didn't see that decline that we've been having, but we actually leveled off and tapered off. And I think one report I read, we actually saw just a minuscule but a 1% increase in our production, which is completely different than what we've been doing for years and years and years. Well, we want to keep our production to a particular level. One of the things that we never talk about much is everybody talks about incentives and different things, but we also have royalty that's involved in our oil. It hasn't been great this year because of the price of oil, but I think, and Commissioner Hoffbeck can probably has better numbers than me. I think at the end of February we were up to maybe $578 million that we'd collected.
Or if you talk to Alaska Oil and Gas Association, which has to represent everybody at one time. So when you talk to the individual participants, you find that the nuclear bomb would work for them in Cook Inlet and maintaining those. But we do want to draw it back, so you have to be under a plan of development, not a plan of expiration, so we use our tax dollars wisely.
Okay, I'm afraid that's where we're going to have to leave it. That's all the time we have for this discussion. Tonight, anyways, I know the discussion is going to go on a lot longer here in Juneau. I want to thank KTOO and 360 North for hosting us here today, and the great crew in front of and behind the camera. Thanks to our guests and to Andrew Kitcherman for helping us moderate this panel with us. The oil and gas tax credit issue remains a contentious issue for the legislature, and I hope we've been able to provide at least a little bit of context on this complex topic. Thanks for watching us tonight. Good night.